The Aztec Empire, an enthralling overview of the history of the Aztecs, starting with a settlement in the Valley of Mexico. Written by Enthralling History. Narrated by Jay Herbert. Introduction. They saw it. They finally saw it. Right there in front of them was an eagle perched on a cactus eating a snake. The prophecy was fulfilled. The people from Aztlan had found the place where they would settle down after countless years of wandering the barren wastelands. The year was AD 1325, and almost 200 years before the first Europeans set foot on the shores of Mexico. A nomadic tribe called the Mexica built their city on a small swampy island, an unlikely location for what would become the capital of a great empire. From unpromising origins, the extraordinary Aztec Empire would soon form and expand into a civilization renowned for military skills, market exchange, fascinating culture, and extensive and sophisticated agricultural endeavors. Through conquest and alliances with other powerful city-states, the Aztecs developed a vast, organized, densely populated empire that encompassed much of today's Mexico. This overview of the Aztec Empire will reveal many of the captivating mysteries of this vast nation. What civilizations existed in the area before the Mexica gained supremacy? Where did the Mexica come from? How did they gain ascendancy over other civilizations and form their extensive network of power? What was the mythology and religion of the Aztecs? And how was their art a reflection of their belief systems? How was their agricultural and market system distinct from surrounding cultures? How did their social order function? This comprehensive and detailed guide to the Aztec Empire will answer these questions and many more about this intriguing nation and its culture. It'll explain the distinctive features of the great empire, what made it exceptional, and how the Aztec culture has had a lasting impact on the modern world. Listeners will gain in-depth insight into who the Aztecs were, not just what they did, but how they lived, what they believed, and how they interacted. Many books have been written about the Aztec Empire, so why is another one needed? Existing books tend to fall into several categories. Some are missing information gleaned from the more recent archaeological finds and scholarly studies. Some are dry and dusty and overly academic. Some focus only on one aspect of the Aztec Empire. And some are simplistic and limited in scope, geared for a child audience. The objective of this audiobook is to provide a well-researched and broad presentation of the Aztec Empire in an easy-to-understand and interesting format that keeps the listener fascinated and engaged. History buffs and those simply curious about the Aztecs will appreciate the depth of information and insight woven into this authoritative work, accompanied by striking illustrations that clarify the narrative and bring the Aztec and other Mesoamerican cultures to life. This guide is divided into four sections, starting with the primary cultures that existed in the area before the Aztec Empire: the Olmecs and Epi-Olmecs, the Toltecs, and the Chichimeca. We will explore how they flourished, what they were famous for, and who were some of their important leaders. We will consider the factors which led to each civilization collapsing, fading into oblivion, or being assimilated by later cultures. Part 2, The Rise of the Aztec Civilization, focuses on the rise of the Aztec Empire, diving into the origins of the Aztec people and how they defined themselves. This section explores the mystery of the Aztecs' home country, Aztlan, in the Lake of the Moon. We will probe theories regarding where it was located and what the word Aztlan means. We'll investigate who the Mexica tribe were and how they rose to become the dominant tribe of the Aztecs in early settlements in the Valley of Mexico. And what's this legend about an eagle eating a snake while perched on a prickly pear cactus? What does this symbolize, and how did it lead to founding a capital city in the middle of a swamp? We will analyze the key elements of the establishment of the Aztec dynasty, how the city-states were organized and connected to each other, and how the Aztecs controlled their Mesoamerican city-states. We'll study how the Triple Alliance was formed and what was their successful strategy of conquest. Part 3, The Spanish Conquest, will explore what happened when the Europeans showed up, How did the Aztecs respond when they first spotted strange ships in the Gulf, like nothing they had ever seen? How did the Spanish conquistador Hernan Cortes cunningly form alliances with the Tlaxcala people, rivals of the Aztecs? This section will probe the events leading up to Emperor Montezuma being held prisoner in his own palace, and the revolt of the Aztecs against the Spaniards following the massacre in the Great Temple. In this section, we will see how the clash played out between two great empires, formerly divided by a great ocean and unknown to the other. How did the Spaniards organize a siege on Tenochtitlan, the Aztec capital? What factors led to the fall of the great city and the Spanish invaders gaining the upper hand? We will examine what happened when the Spaniards took control, how the Aztecs and other indigenous people adapted to Spain's rule and a new way of life, as they were pressured to abandon their idols and convert, on the surface at least, to Catholicism. Part 4. Art, Culture, and Legacy. Reviews of fascinating Aztec culture and their continuing impact, beginning with the Aztec religion and who their gods were. Did they really practice human sacrifice? What were their religious rituals like? We will also examine how their market system worked, analyzing the relationships and trade of the Aztecs with other people, as well as their education system. How did the common people live? We will explore what marriage was like in the Aztec culture and intriguing aspects of family and everyday life. Did you know the Aztecs had a writing system? Their written communication was a form of art, combining pictograms and ideograms. Art was central to Aztec culture, and in Part 4, we will explore the breathtaking beauty of Aztec architecture, sculptures, mosaics, poetry, ceramics, metalwork, and their exquisite featherwork used to dress warriors, priests, and idols. We will examine how their art and other cultural artifacts were influenced by surrounding groups and how they themselves influenced the area around them, even modern-day Mexico and the rest of Mesoamerica. Let's step back in time and begin following the fascinating journey of a people of mysterious origins who built a city in a swamp and proceeded to develop the vast and breathtaking Aztec Empire. Part 1. Before the Aztecs. Chapter 1. The Olmecs and the Epi-Olmecs. What do rubber balls, chocolate, colossal heads, weird jaguars, that's like a werewolf but a jaguar and a human, and a pyramid all have in common? They were all cultural distinctions of the Olmecs, the first major civilization or mother culture of Mesoamerica, a region extending from central Mexico down to northern Costa Rica. Formal agriculture in the Americas, especially the widespread growing of maize, which is corn, goes back to at least the 4th millennium BC, advancing most rapidly in what is now Mexico and Guatemala, as well as the Andes region of South America. Among these farming cultures, the Olmec civilization emerged around 1600 BC in the swampy tropical lowlands close to the Gulf of Mexico, to the south and the east of what is now Mexico City. The rich and well-watered soil in this area supported productive farming, which provided food for a dense population, and the Olmec established three settlements overlooking the Costcuzahualcos River. We don't know the original Olmec name, but their chief settlement is known today as San Lorenzo Tenochtitlan, in what is now the state of Veracruz. To avoid getting confused with a different Mexica-Aztec city named Tenochtitlan, we refer to the Olmec city as just San Lorenzo. San Lorenzo, a ceremonial center for surrounding agricultural villages, was built on a man-made plateau of 140 acres. Which would have required toiling laborers carrying in tons of earth and fill in baskets. Archaeologists were amazed to discover an elaborate drainage system with water storage cisterns, sophisticated for this time period, even in advanced civilizations on the opposite side of the globe. An engineering masterpiece, the Aqueduct of San Lorenzo, featured covered water channels formed from basalt, providing fresh water for the citizens. The settlements flourished over time. And by 1200 BC, San Lorenzo was at its peak. The city proper could have housed 5,000 people, with a possible population of 13,000 in the entire area, the first true city in Mesoamerica. This large population generated an iarchy, with an elite class ruling the city, skilled artisans carving semi-precious minerals, and laborers for the building projects and for farming crops of corn, sweet potatoes, beans, squash, and cassava, and growing avocado and cocoa trees. These foods provided the core diet of the Olmec, along with domesticated dog, their main source of protein, and fish and wild game. Some of the jade and obsidian used in carvings came from as far as Guatemala, made possible by trade on the Coatzacoalcos river system. Because of their extensive trade system, the Olmec had a cultural influence on a wider area than where they lived. Olmec artifacts have been found as far north as present-day Mexico City, and as far south as Guatemala City. Many aspects of Olmec culture were also passed down to future civilizations, including the Aztec. Archaeologists discovered a palace in San Lorenzo made of earthen walls and floors with a plaster finish, colored with red ochre made from the iron oxide hermatite. Carved from basalt, 13-foot columns supported the roof of the Red Palace. The palace would have housed the ruling elite, while commoners lived on the slopes around the city in wattle and daub houses, a framework of wood which was a wattle covered with wet earth or clay called daubing. The word Olmec comes from an Aztec word meaning rubber people, and there's a good reason they were called that. The Panama rubber tree is native to tropical areas in Mexico and Central America. The Olmec harvested the sap from this tree and mixed it with sap from morning glory vines to make it supple, so it could be used to form objects. They would press the rubber sap around stones and make rubber balls. Yes, rubber balls for ball games. The Olmec invented the first rubber balls. Rubber balls have also been found in Olmec sacrificial pits, indicating they might have been sacrificed to deities. They may have also used them under heavy objects, to roll them from one place to another. As the Olmec were also known for huge stone figurines, that would have needed to be transported somehow. Around 900 BC, the city of San Lorenzo declined for unknown reasons, but most likely because rivers in that area changed course during that period. The city would have depended on the rivers for trade and for transporting basalt from the mountains. About the same time, another city emerged as a center of Olmec culture. La Venta, settled around 1200 BC, was about 300 years old at the time of San Lorenzo's decline. It rose to dominance as a leading city of the Olmec and remained so for 500 years. La Venta was in what is now the Mexican state of Tabasco, about 10 miles from the Gulf of Mexico and on the Rio Palma, a tributary of the Tonalá River. The city was constructed on an island in the middle of a swamp, a recurring theme of cultures in the area, which may have provided natural protection. La Venta's population grew to perhaps around 20,000 people, about twice the size of San Lorenzo. Archaeological examination reveals several distinct sections within the city of La Venta, with a temple complex at the north end of the site and a great pyramid just south of the temple. Curiously, the city is aligned 8 degrees west of north, with almost identical east and west sides. A great deal of planning went into this city. The La Venta Pyramid was once thought to be the earliest known pyramid of the Americas. However, we now know that Carol civilization in Peru built pyramids predating the Egyptian pyramids by about 100 years, and the La Venta Pyramid by over 1,000 years. Could the Peruvians have somehow influenced the Olmec culture? Scholars believe a trading system by raft, extending from Peru to Mexico, existed about 1,000 years after the Olmec. They believe this is how civilizations in Mexico suddenly adopted metallurgy around 800 AD. It's conceivable that a raft trade could have existed much earlier, in the Olmec era, or at least there may have been an occasional traveler between the two areas. Regardless of where they got the idea, the La Venta Pyramid ushered in a trend of pyramid building throughout Mesoamerica by various civilizations following the Olmec. What did this pyramid of La Venta look like? It was rectangular, with steps at the sides going up to the top. Today, even after thousands of years of erosion, It stands 112 feet in height. About 100,000 cubic meters of clay was used in the construction. Like other American pyramids, it was built of packed clay and faced with stone. Art was a hallmark of Olmec culture. The Olmec made exceptional carvings in jade, using jadeite jade rather than the nephrite jade used in China. These carvings depicted what is believed to be supernatural creatures, such as the part human and part jaguar mythological were-jaguar. An astonishing art form distinctive to the Olmec were the colossal heads. These awe-inspiring carvings have been found mostly in San Lorenzo, with some in La Venta and a couple in other settlements. These heads were gigantic, up to 11 feet high. Weighing several tons, they were carved from massive volcanic basalt boulders from Charocintepec in the Tuxtlas Mountains, over 50 miles away. Another source of basalt used in the colossal heads was the San Martin volcano. How did the Olmec move these enormous stones over all those miles? The mysterious transportation of these massive carved heads is mind-boggling. They would have had to have been dragged, perhaps on a platform rolled over rubber balls. They could have been transported by raft on the river system, but that would have required exceptional raft-making skills to float an object weighing several tons. It would have taken over 1,000 men laboring for months to get them to their destination. Archaeological evidence indicates the colossal heads were covered with plaster painted in bright colors. Each head is different, and their faces feature full lips, wide noses, and almond-shaped eyes, some with an epicanthic fold, common in Asians and Polynesians. Some people feel they are African in appearance, or perhaps Asian or Polynesian. Is this what the Olmec looked like? What were the origins of the Olmec? Some have theorized that the Olmecs were originally from Africa, but DNA studies on two Olmec remains indicate they had DNA consistent with the indigenous populations of the Americas. No specific DNA link has been found between the Olmec and Polynesia or Africa. Interestingly, though, a DNA study published in Nature in July 2020 links the ancient Xenu, who lived on the Caribbean side of the country of Colombia, to Easter Island and Fatuhiva in Polynesia. Researchers believe this happened around 1200 AD, which would have been long after the Olmec civilization, but it does set the imagination racing. Perhaps future archaeological finds and DNA studies will tell us more. Because the colossal heads can be found at both La Venta and San Lorenzo, we know that producing these massive carvings continued over several centuries. What did they represent? Perhaps each head was that of an Olmec ruler. The heads are carved with some type of headgear, such as a helmet, suggesting an association with the military. Others speculate that the colossal heads represent athletes in the rubber ball games who wore helmets. The Olmec not only invented rubber balls, they were also known for ball games played by two teams with a rubber ball in a sunken pit. The apparent object of the game was to get the ball to the other end of the court without using their hands, kind of like modern soccer. Depictions in Olmec carvings indicate protective equipment was worn, including helmets. The game was likely an ancient form of the ball game ulama, also played by Aztec and Maya civilizations, and still played today in Mesoamerica. In ulama, the ball is hit with a hip, upper thigh, or forearm. About 2,000 ancient ball courts have been found in Mesoamerica. Little is known about the religion and the myths of the Olmec, other than what can be gleaned from artifacts. Sacrifice is part of virtually every culture, and it was practiced by the Olmec. Olmec carvings of a person presenting an inert baby or small child hints at child sacrifice. Partial and complete infant skeletons, found in what are believed to be sacrifice pits, seem to confirm this practice. Other items in the pits suggest sacrifices of metal jewelry, rubber balls, grain, produce, and livestock. Bloodletting, common in later Mesoamerican cultures, is believed to have been part of the sacrificial system, using real and ceramic stingray spikes and shark teeth. Olmec rulers, priests, and shamans all probably had a part in leading religious activities. They had a jaguar god, along with other supernatural beings that they worshipped. The were-jaguar were part of the ancient mythology of the Mesoamericans, including the Olmec. Actual jaguars were at the top of the food chain and had a wide range in ancient times. The were-jaguar was probably an Olmec deity representing supremacy and strength. Were-jaguar figures had almond eyes, a cleft head, and an open mouth turned downward in a sort of a grimace. A were-jaguar image is sometimes depicted as an infant in the arms of a human man, possibly a shamanic practice of harnessing the fierce power of the jaguar, or possibly the mythological offspring of a jaguar mated with a human. Olmec artifacts include jade masks of a jaguar, usually found at shrines, cemeteries, and temples, obviously carrying significant spiritual meaning. Other deities thought to be worshipped by the Olmec included a dragon or earth monster, depicted in their art as having fangs, eyebrows of fire, and a split tongue. Carvings show a maize deity with corn growing from his cleft head. The Olmec may have had a rain spirit, and carvings on bowls show what may be some sort of a band-eye god. A feathered serpent, a common deity in many Mesoamerican religions, was found on a steel carving and in a cave painting. Lastly, the Olmec appeared to have had a fish or a shark deity. Recent archaeological finds show the Olmec apparently developed an early, very primitive writing system. In the late 1990s, workers building a road in what was the Olmec heartland discovered a block of stone in a pile of bulldozer debris, which also included clay figurines that dated back to the San Lorenzo Olmec period. On the block are 62 glyphs, or elemental symbols, resembling maize, pineapple, fish, and insects, as well as more abstract glyphs. The symbols run horizontally, while other forms of Mesoamerican writing or photo writing were all vertical, like ancient Chinese writing. This slab, with its carvings of symbols, generated a lot of controversy. Some scholars hailed it as irrefutable evidence of an early writing system in the Olmec culture. Other scholars felt the slab wasn't as genuinely old as believed, or that the symbols weren't a type of writing. In 1997 and 1998, at an archaeological site 3 miles north of La Venta, three artifacts were uncovered that also appear to point to an Olmec writing system. They dated to about 650 BC, when the Olmec civilization at La Venta was active. One was a cylinder seal, which, when rolled out, showed a bird speaking words or glyphs. Two fragments of a plaque were found that each contained a glyph similar to glyphs used in later Mesoamerican cultures. Now let's move on to what many of us might consider the most interesting aspect of Olmec culture, chocolate. An article in the May 2011 edition of Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences reported on 156 potsherds collected from an archaeological dig at San Lorenzo. Residue in the bowls, cups, and bottles were analyzed at the University of California. Testing revealed that 17% of the potsherds had residue containing theobromine, an alkaloid chemical primarily found in the cocoa plant. The Olmec were drinking chocolate. So the Olmec not only invented rubber balls, but we can also thank them for figuring out how to make chocolate from cocoa beans. As noted earlier, the Olmec culture first emerged in the San Lorenzo area around 1600 BC. In 900 BC, San Lorenzo abruptly declined, and the Olmec city of La Venta rose to prominence as a cultural center or the capital city. La Venta developed and dominated until around 400 BC. When it also suddenly evacuated and abandoned. For the next 2,000 years, the eastern half of the Olmec heartland was sparsely inhabited. A large segment of the Olmec seemed to have suddenly died out. What caused their eventual extinction? Archaeologists believe their depopulation resulted from abrupt and serious changes in the environment to the extent that the area could no longer support a dense population, requiring immense agricultural production and a good river system for trade and transport. We've already speculated on changes to the river courses that likely caused the decline of San Lorenzo. But what about La Venta? Tectonic upheaval and shift could have caused earthquakes and volcanic eruptions in the area, as well as further disruption of the river system that the Olmec depended on. Mexico sits on three of the Earth's largest tectonic plates, and earthquakes are common. The soft soil of the marshy Olmec heartland would have amplified the effects of the tremors. Mexico is the fourth most hazardous country in the world for volcanoes. The San Martin volcano was close to La Venta and erupted as recently as 1796. The El Chichon volcano was also not far away and is still active, last erupting in 1981. The Olmecs lived in the marshy lowlands. Even if a volcano isn't erupting, it can leak lethal carbon dioxide, which can collect in low-lying areas, killing humans, animals, and plant life. The Epi-Olmec. Within a century of the abrupt decline of the Olmec culture, a new culture succeeded it. We refer to them as Epi-Olmec, Epi meaning post or after. As previously mentioned, the eastern part of the Olmec heartland became a virtual wasteland. However, two cities, Tres Zapotes and Cerro de la Mesas, gained prominence in the western part of what was once the Olmec heartland. The Epi-Olmec culture endured for about 550 years, from 300 BC to AD 250, and seemed to be a gradual transformation from the Olmec culture rather than a completely new culture gaining dominance. Although not as large and organized as the Olmec, the Epi-Olmecs developed a sophisticated calendar and writing system. However, their trade system did not equal the Olmec, and their art lacked the Olmec refinement. Several artifacts found in the Epi-Olmec region depict a writing system known as Isthmian script, which may have been descended from the Olmec glyphs. In 1986, the La Mijara Stela was unearthed, an extremely important discovery. This carved monument dates to AD 156 and has 535 glyphs. On the right side of the stone is a carving of a man wearing an elaborate headdress with a hook-beaked bird deity and sharks. This, along with his feathered cape, indicates he is a ruler, a deity, or a priest. Over him are 12 columns of glyphs, and on his right side are 8 more columns of glyphs. In 1997, two linguists, John Judison and Terence Kaufman, published a paper saying they had deciphered the script. They reported that the man is the Harvester Mountain Lord, and that the writings tell of a solar eclipse and appearances of Venus, how the Mountain Lord came to power, his wars, his own bloodletting, and the sacrifice of his brother-in-law. Some archaeologists dispute this translation. The stone also contained two dates in the form of the Mesoamerican Long Court Calendar, which corresponds to the months and the years of May AD 143 and July AD 156. The Long Count Calendar was a system that emerged in the Epi-Olmec era and was found in areas influenced by Olmec cultures. It measured time by calculating the number of days from what they considered their creation date, which would have been 3114 BC in our calendar. Earlier in 1902, the Tuxtla statuette was discovered by a farmer in the foothills of the Tuxtla's mountains. The statuette is in the shape of a man with a duck mouth and wings. On it are carved 75 glyphs, known as Isthmian script and corresponding to La Mijara Stela, and a long count calendar date which corresponds to AD 162. The oldest artifact of the Epi-Olmec, containing calendar entries and glyphs, was Stela C. The bottom half of this monument at the Tres Zapotes archaeological site, and the location of one of the two leading cities of the Epi-Olmec, and the top half was found in 1969. A long count calendar date was carved on this monument that corresponds to September 3rd, 32 BC. On the back of the stela were carved glyphs in the Epi-Olmec Isthmian script. We are fortunate to have these glimpses into the Epi-Olmec culture. Everyday life and homes for the common people did not seem to change much in the transition from Olmec to Epi-Olmec. the Epi-Olmec didn't seem to have had the centralized hierarchy of the Olmec. By AD 250, the culture gave way to the classic Veracruz culture, situated a little further north on the Gulf Coast. Chapter 2. The Toltecs. The Toltec kingdom, known for legendary sculptors and artists, as well as ferocious warrior conquerors, followed the Olmecs as a great Mesoamerican civilization, thriving between AD 600 to 1200. The Toltecs were infamous for regularly practicing human sacrifice of adults and children, and collecting their skulls on a rack in their ceremonial plaza. They were zealous in spreading the cult of Quetzalcoatl, the feathered serpent deity of Mesoamerica, and the name of their most beloved emperor assumed. The Mexica Aztecs greatly revered the Toltecs, collected their sculptures and other relics from the Toltecs' abandoned city, and claimed to be descended from Toltec royalty. What were the origins of these warriors and artists? They are believed to have descended from a wild nomadic people called the Toltec Chimchimica from the deserts of northwestern Mexico and perhaps even southern California. In the 9th century, some of these people migrated southward towards the Valley of Mexico, the area encompassing present Mexico City and eastward to the Gulf of Mexico. In their wanderings, the Toltecs picked up cultural influences from the Olmec and the Maya, and most importantly, the Teotihuacan people. According to the oral and pictograph tradition of the Aztecs, some of these nomads settled in Tlaticachin in the territory of the Huitzilopochtlan people, who called them Tolteca, meaning artisan or architect, from their renown as craftsmen and artists. Led by two chiefs, Chiquiltzin and Tlacamitzin, the Toltecs rebelled against their overlords in AD 544. The Toltecs fought for 13 years, lost the war, and were exiled. The exiles traveled to Tlaxcalancan, where they reunited with part of their clan that had fled Chalatzacatzin earlier. Together they pressed on, reaching a place called Tlapalaconco, where they lived for 3 years. But they feared being so close to the Huitzilopochtlan people, so their council of chieftains decided to migrate further. Their astrologer priest, Humatzin, the man with the long hand, gave them a prophecy of an uninhabited land in the east where they could live. Hearing this, the Toltecs left part of their clan in Tlapalaconco, and the rest would migrate east. They made a solemn vow they would abstain from sexual relations during the migration, so they could travel without the complications of pregnancies and small children. They march east, arriving at Jalisco, where they lived 8 years. Leaving some of their people there, they migrated to Chimalhuacan at Tinio. At this point, they decided they'd gone long enough without sex, so they celebrated a conjugal feast, enjoyed relations with their wives, and eventually started having children again. They built boats and settled in the islands of the area, then later lived all together in one large wooden building in a place called Tulancingo. Finally, in AD.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.